Hey everybody, welcome. My name is Andrew King, and today I'm here to walk you through Business Central Order to Cash. We're really going to talk about a few things in this context. So first of all, I want to talk about really the advantages of Business Central and being on this Microsoft ecosphere is that, you know what? Everything is linked together. All the Microsoft different apps can talk. So what we're going to show today is really how Business Central can be rendered and visible and usable right inside Outlook. Some pretty neat functionality there that we're going to share. Number two is the practical side of when a customer service rep or an order entry rep is inside the system. One of the big challenges we see with customers coming to us from, you know, quite frankly, QuickBooks or other SMB type products is that a real problem with communication. You know, the sales reps in the field would email customer service and try to figure out, you know, what inventory is going to be available and when. And, you know, when you get into forecasting from a supply chain standpoint, do you have a sales and operations process? And how do you determine what the right amount of safety stock and forecasts are? So Microsoft and Dynamics 365 Business Central have done a fantastic job of really embedding that experience, number one, into the sales order itself and figuring out when product can be delivered based on lead times, supply chain, et cetera. And number two, when you get into demand planning and inventory forecasting, using artificial intelligence to really assist in figuring out what that forecast should be, accounting for seasonality and things like that. And we see AI being invested in various different areas in the system in Dynamics 365 Business Central. We'll touch on a little bit of that as well. Finally, or third, shall I say, the ability for the system to readily handle conversion from old systems. You know, we see a lot of clients coming to us from different systems, and you know they're going through a transformation, a digital transformation too. And so their SKU names might have to change, their nomenclatures might have to change, and handling that ability to come from a legacy system where you're calling it product A and now it's product B is not an easy thing to do. Also, especially when you get into distribution and these days of digital transformation, being able to electronically transmit and communicate with vendors and customers and really provide that seamless experience is critical. So being able to handle EDI or electronic data interchange and SKU translations between what maybe one vendor might call a product and what you might call a product or what one of your customers might call a product versus how you name your product, really the ability to handle that seamlessly is critical. Also, obviously, you know, to run an efficient warehouse this day and age, you need barcode scanning, you need you know, live inventory planning, et cetera. So being able to, again, handle multiple barcodes, multiple different nomenclatures and things like that in the system readily is quite critical. Finally, you know, transactions are great, and we're going to spend some time showing you how, you know, how the system works on the transaction level. But ultimately, these systems need to bring reporting up a level for customers. And that's what we really see is people spend a lot of time in Excel manually exporting things from legacy systems, translating, manually emailing back and forth. And what Microsoft and Dynamics really is able to do quite well is make embed Power BI in the solution, make the tables readily available to be rendered within Power BI. And in addition, we typically sell Jet Reports, which is a third-party ISV solution that enables reporting and linkages to the live database right there within Excel, including drill down capability back into Business Central itself. So again, just getting back to that whole seamless experience with the Microsoft ecosphere and how Dynamics 365 Business Central really brings it together. So without further ado, let's jump in to the actual demo here and let's start with our first scenario. So what we're going to do is we're going to pretend that I'm getting an email here from a customer asking for a quote on this blue Tokyo guest chair. And when I go into Business Central, let's take a look, first of all, at that customer, right? So that's coming from this email address that I invented on Gmail here. And if I hit this little button up here for Business Central Contact Insights, what you're going to see is it's using that email address to figure out who the heck that customer is right here. And you can see it's School of Fine Art. So the way it does that is if we come back here into Business Central and let's go into School of Fine Art. And what you'll see is there's that email address right there linked to that account. So because I emailed from there, that is how it reconciled and figured out who I was. Now you can have multiple different email addresses with an account and multiple contacts, but we're not going to get into all that. What I want to show you is right here in the system, let's pretend I'm a sales rep just working in Outlook and I get this email from my customer. I can see a lot of details about that customer right here in my Outlook, and I can see they owe me a bit of money. They owe us quite a bit of past due money. If I want to get the details on that, quite honestly, I can drill right into it from Outlook and see the details of that screen. Now, if that's not enough screen real estate for me, I can pop on out here and look at the details on a much bigger area of real estate. So if I'm right there talking to the customer, I can drill into exactly what all that information is from a practical standpoint. So in this particular example, I've got some outstanding quotes for that particular customer. There's some outstanding orders, ongoing sales invoices. I can also see, how important is this customer to us? We know there's an outstanding balance, but you know what? How much business have we really done with these guys? You can see all their payments in local currency, when we last received a payment, et cetera. So quite a bit of business we're doing with this customer, a lot of sales, a lot of shipped product. So, maybe I'll cut them a little slack and ignore this past due. So, but again, just providing this information right at the push of a button within Outlook is critical because I don't have to go anywhere. I don't have to do anything or log into another system. Obviously, it's all using Active Directory and single sign-on. So it's authenticated me as a user into Business Central with security rights to do these things, but I'm doing it all from within Outlook. Now, the next thing I'm going to do is this customer asked me for a quote. So quite honestly, I'm just going to go create a quote for them. So what the system is doing is using a bit of AI to try to figure out what the heck this product is. So it's got a couple of viable matches here. I'm going to tell the system to go ahead and resolve the item. And okay, they want the Tokyo guest chair. So there it is right there. That's 1964-S. We're going to pick that one. And then we're going to hit okay. So go for it. And so what it's done now, it's actually, I'm in a quote. So it's created a quote right here within my Outlook. Now, again, not a ton of real estate from a screen perspective, but you can see that quote here at $289.60. And so the total value of that quote is $2,896. Now, one of the things we see a lot with customers is the fact that a sales rep might be able to create a quote out in the field, but then they don't know when, is the inventory even available? When would this be able to be fulfilled? How do I know the customer can even get it and when they want it? Now, keep in mind, this is a demo system, so ignore the dates. These are all kind of in the past. But what Microsoft has done for us here is we can hit this little information toggle button, and it again shows me the information about the customer. But now what it's doing is it's looking at this particular sales line and saying, okay, you need 10. By the way, I've got inventory right now of 4, but based on the date you want it, I actually have 28. And so I know instantly for my customer that I'm having the conversation with right now or that I'm about to email back, I know I can fulfill this thing on the date that they want it. So for me, that's a huge amount of information. And this is where the rubber really meets the road with this technology, because at the end of the day, clients will spend in legacy systems and older systems, they will spend a ton of time emailing back and forth or getting on the phone and finding out when inventory can be made available. Okay. So to have that right at my fingertips, even within Outlook, is a huge quantum leap forward. Now, from here, okay, now that I've figured out that, hey, you know what, I can actually fulfill this particular order, then I can go and I can actually email this to my customer. So I can come right here to my menu and I can say, you know what, this thing's ready to go. I've got the inventory. I can fulfill it. I'm going to go ahead and send this quote via email. So it's opening this right now. You'll see my email pop open right integrated to Outlook. So there's the PDF quote. There's the total quote with tax. And I'm going to go ahead and just send this back to my client. So like I said, couple little mouse clicks there. And sure enough, boom, that quote is on its way. And if I open up my my Gmail here, give me one second. I'll just pull that over here. This is the email that I just got. You can see here's a picture of the quote that just went out to the customer. So just a couple of little mouse clicks and there I am. I can have that quote in the customer's hands. Now, here I am in the School of Fine Art in Business Central itself. So let's pretend I'm now a customer service rep whose responsibility now is to take that quote and I'm going to convert it to an actual sales order. So that was quote number 15. I'm going to grab that quote right here, and here's the value of it, $28.96. Okay, and all I need to do now is basically just process that into an order. So we'll hit yes. Oh, sorry, it just refreshed the page there. We just do that again. And we will get ready to process this little, there we go. So we're going to process that into an order. There we go. And we're going to open it. Okay, so here's my sales order for 10 pieces. Now, like we talked about before, okay, you can see there's my inventory, or sorry, there's my order for 10. And again, my item availability is 18. Now, because I'm inside Business Central at this point as a full-blown customer service rep, I can actually just click on that and see what the situation is. So if you recall, my due date on that order was October 31st, 2021. Again, keep in mind this is a demo system, right? So my inventory, current inventory is 4. I remember seeing that. And now I've got this sales order coming in for minus 10, which still leaves me 18 units available. So even if this were out in the future, I can see quite readily from a sales order perspective or from a sales rep perspective, there's a couple POs coming in. They look like they're a little overdue at this point, but there are a couple POs coming in. They're going to make that 18 available to me that I can ship out and meet the requirements of this customer. So typically what a customer service rep would do is they would come up here to actions, plan, and go to order promising. And if they didn't want to look manually, they can simply hit this button that says capable to promise, and the system will quickly do that analysis for them and say, hey, you know what? You're fine to ship this out on the 22nd. I got a couple POs that are coming in. We're good to go on this quantity of 10. So when I accept that, you'll notice that really nothing changed. The system says, hey, no problem. I can still ship this stuff out on the 22nd of October. Now, I know that based on this plan, we have roughly eight, a few more coming in that makes it a total inventory available of 18s. But let's say, as an example, that I actually wanted 40 of them. You'll see that at the very top of the screen, the first message I get is, hey, you know what? I don't have enough. Oh, and by the way, this customer has an overdue balance. Now, we already saw that over there in Outlook, if you recall. This is the system now reminding me that, hey, you might not want to fulfill this order because they do owe us quite a bit of money. But again, we've already said they're a pretty important customer, so we're okay with that. But here now, I've got that 40, and you'll see the item availability has gone negative. So now the question is, well, when the heck can I actually fulfill this? So let's go back and let's look at that plan. So if I go back into here into order promising, I don't know the lead time of this part. You know, I'm in sales. I have no idea when we can cut a PO, what the lead time is, et cetera. But I'm going to click on capable to promise. The system's going to go calculate that, and it's going to say, you know what? You can't fulfill it today, but we will be able to fill that about a month from now or so on November 26th. Now, this is taking into account the lead time of the part, and it's taking into account the amount of time the company needs to just get a PO out the door. So I'm going to say, hey, you know what? No problem. I'll accept that date. And guess what the system automatically does here? It actually changes those dates automatically. So again, I can notify the customer if I'm on the phone with them or dealing with them right now that, hey, this is when we can fulfill that order. And that requirement to be purchased will automatically show up with the inventory planners in their planning worksheets, and they can go process the PO. And this gives us more than enough time to get that inventory in. Now, when that inventory does come in, then I would obviously post that order into a shipment, process it to the warehouse, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not going to show that right now, but that's really what would obviously happen down the road. Okay, so like I said, if we take a look back at these scenarios, number one, being able for the sales reps right out of the box to sit there in Outlook and get all that information at their fingertips means they're not sending emails, they're not having to call anybody, they're not having to even get on Teams and chat about it. Ultimately, they just have that insight right there at their fingertips. And again, from a customer service standpoint, once I'm in that order and I'm processing it, I can look and see when we will be able to ship it. If it were a make item or a manufacturer, then it would take into account those lead times for production. That particular item was a buy item, so it's actually just simply taking into account the usual lead time to receive that material in from that supplier. So as you can infer by that demo, it was around 30 days plus 5 days for order processing time. So just a huge advantage to be able to understand those delivery times. Now, if I take another look in here at that system, let's take a look at that item. So that was 1964-S. We'll pop in there real quick. And like I mentioned earlier, we've got some artificial intelligence here when it comes to forecasting items, being able to understand when we can fulfill orders, etc. Let me just show you here. What the system has done in this case is we're looking back for the past 2 years. What's the total sales history? What's the total amount that we've sold? And then what's that average on a monthly period that I would sell over that time period? Okay. And then what happens after this is, let me just show you this, the forecasting setup. Is we are able to include artificial intelligence in that usage of that sales history in our demand plan. So again, if I'm at the front end as a sales or customer service rep and I'm using that capable to promise, I have to be confident that that information is correct. In other words, are those lead times reliable? Is it accurate that it only takes us a few days to process a PO? So being able to bring artificial intelligence to bear when we actually do the demand planning and demand forecasting to make sure we've got the right inventory available is a huge advantage. And really what this AI does in the background is there is a forecasting model that comes with Dynamics 365 Business Central, and it's simply embedded in the ability to update a sales forecast. So when we look at our demand plan, whoops, what you'll see, and I'm just going to go right in here, okay, is when I give me 1 second, let's view by month here. There we go. And we'll use main. Okay, what the system is doing for all these different items, and you'll see 1964-S is down there and a few of its friends. When I process this, oops, sorry, when I apply the sales history, okay, it's looking back on each of those items with respect to its linear sales history. So just a simple average of what was the quantity we sold over that specific duration of time. And I'm going to forecast out 12 months. Oops, 12, just 12, sorry. When I bring that in, it's actually going to use that AI engine in the background to say, okay, let's take seasonality into account. Let's take other factors into account, standard deviation, etc., and tell me then out in the future what you think, what the system thinks it's going to sell using that artificial intelligence engine. And we can control rounding and various other things here too. But just to give you a sense of the artificial intelligence piece here, it's automatically doing all those calculations in the background for us. So again, huge advantage right out of the box. And you'll see Microsoft starting to include artificial intelligence kind of everywhere here. You'll see there's predicted sales invoices to be past due. Now, keep in mind, this is a demo system, so I don't have a lot of data in here, but it will over time predict those customers that are going to pay you late and try to highlight in advance for you that, hey, you know what? You've got some invoices out there that they are not late right now, but you might start calling those customers because they might very well be late based on history. Okay, so a little bit of AI there. There's also, and I'll get into it in a different video, but there's also artificial intelligence for cash flow forecasting. So again, looking at all the different things that happen, late payers, early payers, if that's even a thing, sometimes, and take all that into account in a cash flow forecast as well. And again, when it comes to cash flow forecasting, we find coming out of legacy systems, it's really archaic. People are manually adding up documents and receivables and purchase orders, and Business Central really fixes that for them. So, couple other things I want to talk about today, just switching subjects, is really the ability of the system to handle number one, converting data from legacy systems, handling new technology like electronic data interchange and barcode scanning, inventory management. Those are really becoming staples of business in distribution, manufacturing today. You have to be able to communicate seamlessly, whether it be through e-commerce or through with customers or even vendors, and the ability to handle that is critical. And what you'll find, a lot of customers that we have deal with Amazon, Walmart, etc. They might not call the particular SKUs that our customers have the same as the customers. They might have a completely different item code. So again, if we come back into Business Central, and let's take a look at our little item we've been playing with here. Come up here to related item and item references, you'll see that in the database, I can maintain for a particular customer, so this customer, that They call my product 1964-SA. And for this customer, they actually call it 1964-B. And when I buy it from one particular vendor, they call it Guest CH0001. So I can, on my sales orders, on my purchase orders to these customers or to these vendors, I can literally key in those codes, or I can key in my code, and then on the paperwork for those particular customers, i.e. the sales invoice, the sales order, the sales quote, etc., it would print these reference numbers, and on the PO it would print this reference number versus what I internally call it. But for my warehouse, for my inventory folks, for my sales order entry people, sales people, etc., we can always call it by our own internal code, this 1964-S. So this gives us great capability. Also, when it comes to electronic data interchange or e-commerce in particular, some of my customers or some of my clients' customers might call it something completely different. And that's what we want to actually send to them electronically through EDI. That's what we want to have up maybe on our website for e-commerce. In addition, in the warehouse, when I receive, let's assume for the sake of argument, I buy this product from multiple different vendors. And one vendor has this barcode on it, another vendor has this barcode on it. And when I receive it in the warehouse, I don't want to be fumbling around trying to figure out what product I'm receiving and when and looking up stuff manually. So we can actually maintain right here in the system different barcode codes. So when I scan it in the warehouse, it always reconciles back to this item. Okay, that's a huge capability that from a practical standpoint gets in the way of customers coming off legacy systems of operating a warehouse seamlessly. Okay, and in today's day and age, you know, especially like I mentioned earlier with Amazon and Walmart, you know, they're pretty demanding customers, but yet the reward is a lot of volume. So at the end of the day, you want to make them happy. So let them call your products whatever the heck they want to call them, and we can maintain that in the system. You can also see over here on the side, you know, when it comes to e-commerce, a lot of problems with, again, clients coming from legacy systems, they're manually uploading a catalog to the e-commerce platform. They're manually maintaining price lists. They're manually maintaining the item attributes. We can store all that stuff inside Business Central, feed it to the e-commerce platform, doesn't matter what it is, whether it's Shopify, Microsoft has embedded Shopify app, Magento, Sana, KE Commerce, there's lots of different e-commerce platforms. We can store all that information right here in Business Central, including all the different attributes of the product, feed that up into our e-commerce site, and we don't have to double enter or maintain a separate catalog or deal with CSV files or anything like that. In addition, as the world gets smaller, as the world becomes more seamless, what you end up with is also the need for us to maintain different language translations of items. So we might have a division, say, in Europe or in Mexico or in Spain or what have you, in France, in Canada, it's very common, obviously, Quebec, right? I want to seamlessly maintain these different language translations of my items without having to manually maintain a whole bunch of stuff on the side. So we can maintain that right here in the system, depending on what user logs in, and quite frankly, even the language of the customer or the vendor, we can insert these translated values right onto those documents or show that for a particular user in a different language. So Business Central is multilingual as well, and that's not an issue remotely. So it can handle all that right out of the box. Okay, so all that being said, if we come back to our home screen where it all kind of starts to come together, you can see here I've got a dashboard on what are my sales this month. I've got some nice little widgets just sort of telling me what my top sales were, my biggest sales order and things like that I could drill it down into if I wanted to. I can see if there's overdue sales invoices that are out there that need to be, you know, maybe I need to chase down the customer, purchase orders that are outstanding, etc. As I come down here, I've now got a graphical representation of my business. So here's a little income and expense by month. I could look at cash flow as well. We'll get into cash flow, like I said, in a separate video. I could look at the cash cycle. I could look at my top customers. Okay, I've got a little mini P&L here that I can drill down on if I want into the actual transactions. So I can go all the way back from revenue. I can click on a particular invoice and see what the heck that invoice for $2,800 was for. You'll see here, if I just click on it, then I can see exactly what it was for, who processed it, etc. So all that information, even from my home screen, is readily available, right, to drill down on. Now, as I mentioned earlier, I implied earlier, you know, Power BI is readily integrated into Dynamics 365, and you'll see here this little Power BI report right embedded. Now, I can also use what I'll call the full-blown Power BI on its own, and I can come in here into Web Services in Business Central, and I can publish different pages and views of the system. So I can ensure that if I want a Power BI report on purchase orders, vendor information, items, etc., all I simply have to do is publish that information here on the Web Services, and I can pick it up in Power BI. So as an example, from a sales perspective, in Power BI, this is a very simple dashboard, just simply showing what my sales were for a particular product line, profitability by groups of products. So I can even filter and say, hey, you know, how are we doing with desks? Who's buying our desks? As an example, it looks like over here in Nova Scotia and a little bit in Ottawa, and you can see the customers here, and you can see the salespeople that have sold it before. I can see also, you know, the profitability of those items. If I go back into Business Central real quick, what you'll see is, let's go to that 1964-S item as an example. And all the while I'm selling this product, the system's keeping a running total of its profitability, right? You can see that right here. My profit percent. So I'm selling it for $289.60 on average, and my profit is typically $22.03. So the system's tracking that the whole time. I can leverage that in Power BI. Okay, I can have some really amazing dashboards built as well in Power BI, tying into the financial side, budgeting side, etc. So here's a quick sales overview of my actual to budget. I can look at it again by customer. I can look at, if I want to look at just a sales table of maybe by region. So in the GL, again, we'll cover it in a separate video, but in the GL, we can report by dimension or division, if you will. I can look at sales by salesperson. Okay, lots of different comparisons I can do because all that information is right there in the database. And I can drill down, you know, pretty deep. I can see how they're doing year over year. We can go down into detail by product code or product grouping and see how they're selling. From an inventory perspective, I can look at my inventory turns. I can look at my inventory value. I can see what products are selling well, what products aren't selling well. Maybe I need to look at substitutions or end of life. All that information, because Microsoft provides the ability to connect quite readily to Power BI, we can build amazing dashboards to show information. Now, we also we sell some pretty advanced Excel reporting with Dynamics 365 Business Central. So here's a quick example of a P&L by company. So I've got multiple different companies in my sandbox environment. You can see kind of all of them here across the top. And so if I want to look at a particular one, here's my whole consolidated, by the way, P&L over here. If I want to take a look at one particular company, so this was that Cronus Canada company that I was just in. I want to understand what the heck is the $16,000 here. Well, guess what I can do right from Excel? I can click on it. And what it's going to do is it's going to launch Business Central on a tab in my browser. I'm just going to drag it right over here. And you can see here's what makes up that $16,000. You can actually see the two transactions right there. So again, this is a third-party ISV solution that's available in Business Central called Jet Reports. Like I said, clients are, we sell about 100 out-of-the-box Jet Reports with every single implementation of Business Central. And clients are thrilled because they hit the ground running with all the financial and operational reporting that they need. You can see a bit of a different flavor here. Here's an executive dashboard with a whole ton of different metrics about the business, all again coming right from Business Central. And one of the things Microsoft has done is really enabled us to publish apps. Just give me a sense. Oops, I actually called extension in Business Central. So there's an extension marketplace that exists where all these apps are published. And you can see all these different apps. There's AP automation, expense management, document OCR reading. I mean, it just goes on and on. Barcode scanning, things like that. So there's a whole bunch of different apps that are available to be embedded right into Dynamics 365. And again, if I take a look at this particular environment, you can see all the different apps that we've got up and running from different providers all over the place. There's that auto inventory forecasting that I showed you. There's Insight Jet Reports, there's Invoice History. Here's that Jet Reports plugin that I was just showing you in Excel. So there's a whole bunch of add-ins that we can very easily deploy with the click of a button into our Business Central environment. So like I started off in the beginning, really saying, what Microsoft is doing with Dynamics 365 Business Central is looking at those practical challenges that businesses face when they're going through a digital transformation and trying to take their business to the next level, and really embedding those in all the tools we use today. So whether it be inventory visibility and creating quotes just from an email right there in Outlook, to quite readily being able to anticipate when can I have a product for a particular customer, even if I don't have it today, how can I seamlessly integrate into e-commerce, communicate with my vendors, communicate with my customers, how can I enable barcode scanning, how can I enable multilingual capabilities across the enterprise, multiple companies, et cetera. And then finally, the most important reason that anybody invests in these ERP platforms is obviously for better reporting, for dashboards and things like that. And so between, you know, Jet Reports, which are Excel-based, more tabular reporting, and then Power BI, which is very graphical intensive, and dashboards, executive views, some really powerful information brought to bear just at the tips of your fingertips. So again, really, really bringing technology to the next level and embedding it within the entire Microsoft ecosphere. So thanks so much for your time. And like I said, we're going to have a few more videos. We're going to get into finance. We're going to get into purchasing and a couple other areas as well in this series. But thanks for joining us today, and we'll see you soon.